Ancient Aliens is an American television series which premiered on April 20th, 2010 on the History Channel. The program presents the so-called ancient astronaut theory, which is the idea that extraterrestrials visited the Earth in the ancient past, and that historical text, archaeological records, and various legends contain evidence of this contact. I used to believe that the ancient astronaut theory was true. I spent years learning about it from the popular authors, from video presentations and radio shows. I was an enthusiastic promoter of this idea to my friends and family. Although I no longer feel that way, I want you to know that I have no personal reasons to reject this theory. My current worldview could easily accommodate the existence of extraterrestrials. I hope you will come away from this film, even if you disagree with it, saying that I fairly reviewed the claims of ancient aliens without bias and with respect. I hope to show you that this is not a matter of ancient aliens getting a few details wrong here and there and their main premise remaining true. That is not an option in my opinion. I hope to demonstrate to you that they are wrong not on some, but on every single point where they assert an ancient astronaut theory to explain evidence, and that often they are using deceptive means to do this, and sometimes even fabricating evidence to make their points, as we will see. I would also like the viewer to know that unlike many skeptics of the ancient astronaut theory, I actually concede that something out of the ordinary could have occurred in the ancient past, and that there are certain consistent themes in ancient mythologies and the like that require good explanations, but I think you will quickly see that the ancient astronaut theories do not explain this evidence. You will notice a number that appears periodically on the bottom right-hand corner of the screen throughout this film. This number will appear when I am making a claim that requires a reference in order to back it up, and it will correspond to a number on the companion website ancientaliensdebunked.com. This film is divided into three main sections, and each topic can be viewed independently at the website if you choose. I will occasionally be joined by commentary from Dr. Michael Heiser, one of the few actual scholars who has been willing to interact with the ancient astronaut theory. Dr. Heiser has been one of the most articulate proponents of the skeptical viewpoint of this theory, and has written papers and books, as well as almost a dozen websites on the issues we will be covering in this film. We are happy to have him as a part of this film, and we're happy to have you, the viewer, here as well. I encourage you to have an open mind and enjoy the film.
Puma Punku is so unique in the way that it was constructed and shaped and positioned that it is the most intriguing ancient site on the planet.
While the pyramids at Giza are incredible feat of achievement, compared to Puma Punku, the pyramids are child play. In my opinion, the most significant piece of evidence that we have in this entire ancient astronaut puzzle is Puma Punku in the highland of Bolivia.
Well, if Puma Punku is considered such good evidence for the ancient astronaut theory, we should probably start off by looking at it. After all, it's the one that they say was built directly by extraterrestrials.
Puma Punku is the only site on planet Earth that, in my opinion, was built directly by extraterrestrials.
Ancient Aliens starts off with a false dilemma by making people think that it was absolutely impossible for ancient people to construct Puma Punku, even to the point of making outright false claims.
One of the most intriguing things there is that the stones that were used there aren't sandstone, they're granite and diorite. The only stone that's harder than diorite is diamond. So the only way that this could have been achieved is if the tools were tipped with diamonds.
This is funny because it's totally wrong. The stones are not granite or diorite at Puma Punku. They are red sandstone and andesite. But this is also funny because of the way that he says it.
The stones that were used there aren't sandstone, they're granite and diorite.
Well, yeah, actually, it is sandstone. You can't blame him, though. It becomes obvious that throughout the series, he often just repeats things he's heard in Erich von Däniken's books. Von Däniken's books are what the Ancient Aliens series is based on. Later, we see Erich von Däniken himself make the exact same, totally wrong claim.
of course, made out of stones found on Earth, because you don't transport granite or diorite from another solar system.
Von Däniken continues building up this false dilemma.
One of these platforms is 800 tons.
This is very incorrect. The heaviest block at Puma Punku is 130 tons, and most of the stones are much smaller than that, so he's off by a whopping 670 tons. Unfortunately, we will come to expect this kind of thing from Von Däniken as we progress. Ancient Aliens spends quite a lot of time pointing out the various features in the stonemasonry at Puma Punku, and then declaring it impossible to do without power tools.
Each of these small drill holes are basically evenly spaced along this router groove. To me, it's clear that power tools have been used on this unusual block of stone here.
Well, exactly, and this surface is as smooth as a tabletop, like in your kitchen. There's no wave to it or anything. This was machined.
The sandstone and andesite stones at Puma Punku would have been easily worked with the most basic stoneworking tools. The idea that diamond-tipped power saws were needed is ridiculous. The red sandstone was relatively soft and easy to work with, and even though andesite is pretty hard, because of the way it cooled, it could easily be flaked off using stones as soft as 5.5 on the Mohs scale. Such pounding stones were found all over the andesite quarries in the area. Contrary to Ancient Aliens' claims that archaeologists are baffled by Puma Punku, archaeologists know the basics about how Puma Punku's stones were cut and shaped. This is partly because there is evidence for this all over the site itself. They actually used a method that almost all ancient stoneworkers used. They used hard pounding stones to pound out trough-like depressions. Later on, they used flat stones and sand to grind the stone to make a polished surface. We will see later on that this is also how the Egyptians, thousands of years before this, made their flat-surfaced granite monuments like obelisks. Sand, as we will see later when we look at Egypt, has extremely hard particles in it, and if placed between a flat surface and a rock, can polish even the hardest stones known to man. In fact, the harder the stone is, the better it can be polished using sand. We will also see how sand can turn a piece of copper into a very efficient granite saw or granite drill, a method which the Egyptians utilized quite well. Some stones at Puma Punku that Ancient Aliens would never show the cameras are the ones that are in the middle of this process. They show that at the same time a stone was being pounded by stone hammers, which created these trough-like depressions, the grinding and polishing was taking place on the other end of the stone. Unfinished stones like this one clearly show how they were shaped, and it wasn't with lasers. There's also unmistakable evidence of stone hammers having been used in places that were never meant to be visible, like where certain stones would be connected with one another. And because of that, it's hard for me to believe Erich von Däniken in this next clip, because it would mean that the alien toolbox had a laser gun right next to a stone hammer.
Extraterrestrials arrive. The spaceship stands in orbit. Only a smaller space vehicle comes down like a space shuttle. So, just to protect their instruments, they make overnight, with their technology, what we call a base camp. Of course, made out of stones found on Earth, because you don't transport granite or diorite from another solar system. And then they disappear. But the wall of their base camp is still there.
It is true that stone tools would not be enough to construct Puma Punku, especially for some of the finer points. For that, they would need metal chisels and the equivalent of a carpenter's square. Entire studies have been done detailing how these cuts were made, and nothing spectacular is required except some metal tools like chisels. The arguments against this are usually either that a particular culture did not yet know how to cast metals, or that copper chisels would have been too weak. On the first point, we know that the pre-Incan Andean culture was very skilled at fashioning metals and creating metal alloys. In fact, the people who built Puma Punku were even pouring copper alloys into molds right on site, showing that they had more than enough capability to form all kinds of metal tools. But the question is, what about the tool's strength? Well, even if they were pouring pure copper into a mold, it would still work, but it would need sharpening often. But because archaeologists actually found a few of these metal cramps used by them on site, we now know that they were using a very strong copper-arsenic-nickel alloy, which made a much stronger final product. Arsenic acts as a deoxidant, preventing the metal from becoming too brittle, and nickel was used in copper alloys specifically to make strong chisels. Once you understand that they had the ability to make strong metal tools in a huge variety of shapes, there is no part of Puma Punku's stonework that would have been too difficult for them. Well, what about these 90-degree right angles that ancient aliens make so much about?
One of the amazing things here at Puma Punku is the precision of the blocks. You can see with this block of granite that it's really been cut at very accurate right angles.
To make flat surfaces with right angles, you don't need alien technology. You only need a square or a simple equivalent. It's important to keep in mind that Puma Punku would have been built thousands of years after the Egyptians, who had all kinds of squares and plumb bobs and levels and so on. It's a pretty basic stoneworking tool. That being said, despite what ancient aliens says, Puma Punku is not all perfect right angles. You can even see this, ironically enough, as the ancient aliens crew goes around with carpenter squares. You can see that some of them are simply not square. Also, they make claims like all the H blocks are the same dimensions, which they say suggest that they were made by a big machine. But not only would that not be the only conclusion if it were true, it's not even true. The dimensions of the H blocks are not all the same, though they are close. It's probably the case that they were made using the same plans. Speaking of plans,
mainstream archaeologists say that Puma Punku was built by the Aymara Indians. And we would all have to agree that in order to build something like Puma Punku, you need writing, you need planning, and you need some sort of a idea where which piece goes and how it ultimately all fits together. But there is one thing that all the mainstream archaeologists agree upon, that the Aymara didn't have any writing. So how is it possible that they built all of this without plans?
The builders of Puma Punku may not have had an alphabet, but they did use the common iconography or artwork of their culture called Yayamama. All the icons on the site are Yayamama, not secret alien code, and this is but one of the many indications of the culture and time that it was built. But my point is that like many cultures, they used pictures instead of an alphabet, and most building plans are done through pictures, like blueprints for example. So saying that no alphabet means no planning is pretty ridiculous in my opinion. Well, what about moving the stones and lifting them into place? Surely that would have required levitation.
How these massive blocks of granite were moved from their quarries and brought here to Puma Punku would have required some kind of super technology. Levitation and anti-gravity. Huge lifting vehicles, something that ancient aliens would have had.
If they did know how to levitate these stones, then they put far too much effort into creating places in the stones to attach ropes to. Many stones at Puma Punku have grooves several centimeters in width and depth on two adjacent faces for holding ropes. They even had special places cut into the stones that Puma Punku scholars call hoisting grips. All very strange things to do if they could simply levitate these blocks. And to make matters worse for the ancient astronaut theory here, according to archaeologist Jean-Pierre Protzen, who is an expert on Puma Punku, there is almost no stone at the Puma Punku site that does not have what he calls drag marks on one of its faces, where it has been, well, dragged to the site. Ancient Aliens throws up another false dilemma here.
What nobody talks about is the irrefutable fact that we are at an altitude of 12,800 feet, which means we are above the natural tree line. No trees ever grew in that area, meaning no trees were cut down in order to use wooden rollers. The wooden roller theory falls by the wayside.
This is like saying that there's no way that the Egyptians used wood because trees didn't grow in Egypt, which is true. The difference is that while the Egyptians had to import wood from places like Lebanon, it would have been far easier for those at Puma Punku to solve this problem, All they would have had to do is simply walk down the hill a little bit. Okay, well, what about this claim?
Logic does not exist at Puma Punku because there we have megalithic structures which just lie about this entire site as if ripped apart by some sort of a great force.
I propose that logic still exists at Puma Punku, and that the scattered state of the complex can easily be explained. Quoting from archaeologist Alexei Vranich, quote, "The high quality of the stones made it attractive building material for houses, churches, plazas, bridges, even railways." In other words, the stones were pulled down and hauled off by locals for building material. In fact, we have the 400-year-old writings of a visitor to Puma Punku who said that the looting was in full swing even back then. He wrote that if the site was closer to town, he didn't think there would have been any stones left at all. Ancient Alien says that Puma Punku is 17,000 years old. This is what Vranich said of this claim. Quote, "The idea that Tiwanaku is 14,000 years old is based on a rather faulty study done in 1926. Since then, there has been a huge quantity of work, both on the archaeology and the geology of the area, and all data indicates that Tiwanaku existed from around AD 300 to 500. For more information on the faulty study he's referring to here, I will quote at length from Jason Colavito, who has been debunking ancient astronaut theories for years in his books and blogs. He said the following about this claim. Quote, "Tiwanaku is not 17,000 years old. This date derives from the work of Arthur Poznanski, who tried to apply archaeoastronomy to the site, but did so in ways that modern scholars do not recognize as legitimate. Poznanski proposed a date of 15,000 BP, before present, i.e. 13,000 BCE, which the geniuses on Ancient Aliens misread as 15,000 BCE, adding an extra 2,000 years onto Poznanski's already flawed dates. Here's what he did wrong. Poznanski assumed that the Kala Sisaya Temple at Tiwanaku was laid out with perfect accuracy to align to the equinoxes and solstices that he felt but could not prove were important to the Tiwanaku people. Thus, on a certain day, the sun was supposed to rise above one rock at the temple and set behind another. Ah, but which rock should we choose? Since the current ruins do not align with these celestial events accurately, he concluded that the ruins must have been built at a time when they would have aligned with that event. Since the sun and sky change positions at a predictable rate due to the gradual changes in the angle of the Earth's axis, he concluded that the Kala Sisaya Temple was built in 13,000 BCE as a solar observatory, despite no other evidence of solar astronomy at the site. The long and the short of it is that Poznanski assumed celestial alignments and assumed flawless construction, and then used his assumptions to prove that his assumptions were correct. Colavito also has this picture of the site with the caption, "Pick a rock, any rock, one of them must align with something." This site has been dated using a huge variety of methods, things like carbon dating, the type of metals they used, the debris found in certain places, the type of iconography they used. Literally every kind of dating method applied comes to the same conclusion. It was constructed in the early Middle Ages. Before we conclude this section on Puma Punku, there are two other claims I wanted to address.
The Spanish conqueror asked the Inca, the people living there, including the king of the Inca, "What is this Puma Punku?" And they all said, "It's not us. It's not our forefather who make this. This was made by the gods in one single night." Usually a king is proud about what his people did, about the precision and so on. In that case, the chief and the people said, "No, it was not us. It was the gods who made it."
If you understand a little about the Incan imperial system and religion, you will understand why the Incans didn't claim the site, and even why they claimed that it had a supernatural origin. Part of the Incan state religion was that the Incan Empire was the first civilization, and it was created by God himself. It was a very convenient idea for bolstering the Incan case for the right to rule everyone else. When the Incans arrived at Puma Punku, the site had already been abandoned for at least 100 years. Admitting that there was a pre-Incan culture at all, let alone one with more skill than them, would have been detrimental to the whole scheme. So they slightly modified their already existing mythology to include Puma Punku. So instead of Viracocha creating the Incan capital, he also created Puma Punku. And just like that, the Incans were still the oldest and greatest civilization, even though everyone probably knew it wasn't true. And finally, Ancient Aliens says the following about what the ancient local people believed regarding who constructed Puma Punku.
Local legends suggest that Tiwanaku was built as a site of religious pilgrimage to celebrate the arrival of sky gods.
But this is a total lie. Viracocha came from the sea, not from the sky. This is a very sneaky move by Ancient Aliens, in my opinion. So, in conclusion, the stones are not made of granite and diorite. The stones were easily workable with the tools available to the Andean culture, tools which we know included high-quality metal alloyed chisels. These tools would have been more than sufficient to make the angles seen at Puma Punku. The faces of the rocks have been finished using a polishing technique after being rough cut using stone hammers, evidenced by the unfinished stones and hidden areas of the finished stones. The moving of the stones was not as difficult as Ancient Aliens makes it seem, especially when you take into account that they are telling people that the stones weigh 600 tons more than they actually do. The stones have telltale drag marks and hoisting holes for ropes, all showing that they were not levitated as Ancient Aliens would have us believe. We know the culture which built this monument, and all the iconography and sculptures are consistent with that culture, and the various methods of dating that scientists use all point to the same time period. The idea that Puma Punku was from Atlantean times, we now know is based on a very transparently flawed presupposition.
Perhaps the most familiar and most mysterious megalithic structure in all the world is the Great Pyramid of Giza. The enormous size and weight of the stones, multiplied by the sheer number of them, makes one thing certain. The construction of the Great Pyramid remains one of the greatest marvels and mysteries of architectural engineering.
There are all kinds of theories on how the Great Pyramid of Giza was built. So many theories, you just sit back and shake your head. And that includes ET visitations, levitating the blocks with some kind of sound system.
In order to really move massive amounts of stone like that, they would have had to have been levitated, somehow made weightless, and then just moved through the air by some kind of device, perhaps even a handheld kind of device, like some beam weapon.
Thank you. I think it's a good thing to be able to do.
Eastern Lebanon, the Bekaa Valley. Here, at this archaeological site, stand the ruins of Heliopolis, built in the 4th century BC by Alexander the Great to honor Zeus. But beneath the Corinthian columns and remnants of both Greek and Roman architecture lie the ruins of a site that is much, much older. According to archaeologists, it dates back nearly 9,000 years. The ancient city of Baalbek, named after the early Canaanite deity, Baal.
And so because it was already sacred to the god Baal, then later the Greeks and the Romans then would build temples on this very same spot.
Archaeological surveys have revealed that the enormous stone foundation that lies at the base of the site dates back tens of thousands of years. But even more significant to ancient astronaut theorists is their belief that the colossal stone platform may once have served as a landing pad for space travelers.
The idea that ancient aliens will try to convey is that underneath the Roman ruins lies a very old platform that was once used to launch spacecraft. As we watch the next clip, listen for the first thing they cite as evidence for this claim.
But what was originally there before the Roman temple was this spaceport platform that was apparently used for extraterrestrials coming and going on planet Earth.
As evidence, researchers point to the gigantic megalithic stones incorporated into the foundation, each weighing between 800 to 1,200 tons, and perfectly fitted together.
These three stones they're referring to are called the trilithons, and the heaviest of the three is 800 tons, not 1,200 tons as they say. There are two other stones that are heavier than this around the area, but they are unused, still connected to the bedrock in the quarries, and thus are obviously not part of the trilithons. The way the information is presented about these three stones leads the viewer to believe that they are part of the foundation, or platform, of the Baalbek site. What they want the viewer to think is that spacecraft lifted off and landed on the stones of this platform. They also claim that these three stones cannot be of Roman construction, as the mainstream archaeologists believe, but they say that they were part of the earliest structure at the Baalbek site, and that the Greeks and Romans only built on top of this ancient foundation. And it is true that there was a very old pre-Roman temple at this site, but we will learn more about that later. Our focus at the moment is the trilithon stones. Ancient Alien says that these three stones are the real mystery of Baalbek.
This is the real mystery of Baalbek, how these stones came to be there, why they were placed there, and specifically how they were transported into place, because some of the stones are of such magnitude that modern machinery is incapable of putting them there, but somehow our ancestors were able to do this.
To solve this mystery, we need to first understand that these three stones do not form the foundation of Baalbek, as is so often suggested. The trilithon stones lay end to end, or long ways, and are part of the narrow wall on the western end of the complex. They are most certainly not the foundation, nor do they constitute a platform, and it would be very awkward for a spaceship to land on top of them, considering the space on top is so narrow. Ancient Aliens tries to make it seem like no one knows the purpose for these stones, or why they had to be so heavy.
But if the moving, hoisting, and setting of such massive stones was so incredibly difficult, then who, or what, placed them there? And perhaps more importantly, why?
The truth is that the purpose for this wall is very well known by archaeologists. It was a retaining wall. Retaining wall technology really improved with the Greeks, because of the importance of the amphitheater in their culture. Because most amphitheaters were sunken into the ground and surrounded by earth, they needed to construct retaining walls to hold back the soil. Then the Romans came along and basically perfected the practice. The rule of thumb in retaining walls, even today, is the bigger and heavier the stones, the better the retaining wall. Also, the stones needed to be in as big of sections as possible. In other words, huge sections of uncut stone. It's no coincidence that some of the biggest single stones in the ancient world, besides Baalbek, are also used in retaining walls, and by the Romans as well, as we will see. Retaining walls were especially important if there was a lot of soil erosion at the site, or if the platform you were trying to build was on a steep incline. At Baalbek, the platform was built right on the side of a huge hill, so for that reason alone, it would require a retaining wall if they intended to make a large level platform. But if you added to that a soil erosion problem, you would have two very good reasons for a huge retaining wall at Baalbek. So, does the area around Baalbek have a problem with soil erosion? The answer is yes, probably one of the biggest in the world. You can see evidence of soil erosion all around the Baalbek site. The soil from the top of the hill has been sliding down the hill into the valley below for hundreds of years. One of the leading causes of soil erosion is deforestation. If an area that once had trees has been completely cleared of those trees, the rain no longer will have anything to slow down its velocity. Normally, the rain hits tree branches and the thick foliage that accumulates on the forest floor over time. Also, the soil is kept in check by the root systems of the trees, which hold the soil in place. Lebanon has a picture of a cedar tree on its flag. Their trees have been a symbol of pride for literally millennia, the so-called cedars of Lebanon. But the forests have disappeared long ago, as they were one of the only sites for timber in the ancient Near East, and it was massively deforested in ancient times. In fact, the soil shifting is just as bad today in the Bekaa Valley. The UN in 2006 proposed a series of solutions to deal with this now full-scale environmental disaster in the Baalbek region. Homes in the region are being abandoned as their foundations shift and they become inhabitable. But although these proposed solutions by the UN may be new, this problem is an ancient one, one the Romans would have been well aware of. The massive trilithon stones provided the weight needed to press down and secure the stones in the wall below. This is why you only see these huge stones on one side of Baalbek, the side where the steep slope is. The idea that these stones were part of a platform and were used as a landing pad is something that requires ignorance of the layout of the site in order to believe. Well, what about the age of this wall? Is it from the Roman period of construction, or is it from the pre-Roman Canaanite era? There is a lot of confusion about this point because there was indeed a very old pre-Roman temple on this site. The pre-Roman Canaanite temple was a pretty standard platform and altar, much like other sites built by the Canaanites, which were referred to in the Old Testament as high places. The original site was probably chosen by the Canaanites because it was indeed on a hill, as any good high place should be, but also because it was less than half a mile from the perfect stone quarry. The early versions of this temple, however, did not have a retaining wall. As the different groups added to the site over the years, the site changed drastically. The Romans alone spent 200 years doing construction at the site. Think of that. That would be like starting a construction project in 1812 that only just now came to completion. That's a long time to be working on a project. So yes, Baalbek is built on a very old Canaanite altar to Baal, but the trilithon stones were not part of that site, nor are they part of the foundation as is often claimed. They are part of a very necessary retaining wall. The question still remains, however, about the methods for moving and lifting these stones.
Some have suggested that this stone alone weighs in excess of 1,200 tons. How was it moved there? Because obviously it's situated on top of these stone rows that we can find down here, which means that this stone had to be lifted and then set on top of these stones down here.
So, did the Romans have the technology to move and lift such stones? Well, all you have to do is look one country over to find out. About the same time the Romans were beginning their 200-year project at Baalbek, another project of similar magnitude was beginning by the Roman client king Herod the Great in 19 BC. Herod, using Roman techniques, renovated the Temple Mount to earn favor with the Jews, who viewed him as a Roman proxy, not a Jew. The expanded version of the temple was double the size of the original, but in order to make this expansion, he had to incorporate part of the hill to the northeast, which meant that he had to construct a massive retaining wall in order to hold back the force of the earth in order to build the massive platform. There is a portion of this retaining wall still standing today, and it contains the second largest set of single stones next to Baalbek. Just like Baalbek, there are several of these stones lined up to form the wall and to provide the weight and size needed to hold back the earth. They call the four largest stones the Master Course. The weight of the heaviest one is 630 tons, only a little over 100 tons less than Baalbek's biggest stone. And no one denies that these stones were cut, moved, and lifted to perfection using Roman and local techniques. As a side note, it's tempting to think that the holes visible in these stones were used for lifting, but these holes were cut after the stones were placed. They were used to hold plaster in place for certain water projects and only go a few inches deep. Anyway, is it really logical to believe that the Romans could cut, move, and lift 630-ton blocks for retaining walls just fine, but if you added another 100 tons, it would require alien technology? We know that the Romans, about this same time, had taken a liking to Egyptian obelisks. They started dragging these obelisks back to Rome in large numbers, and Rome was hundreds of miles by land and sea from Egypt, whereas Baalbek was less than a mile from the quarry. Some of these obelisks were almost 500 tons, so the Romans had a lot of opportunities to get good at moving stones about the same size and shape of the trilithon stones. There are even Roman descriptions of the process of moving obelisks by Marcellinus Comus, as well as reliefs such as the one on the bottom of the Theodosius obelisk in Istanbul. The ancient Roman writings of Marcus Vitruvius Pollio describe in detail many of the Roman technological advantages, like pulleys, which would reduce the force needed by half for each pulley used. He even described their ingenious way of moving stones by constructing huge oak wheels on either end of the block, whether they were round like pillars or huge rectangular stones like the trilithons. They would then be pulled by oxen to the site. So what about the lifting of the trilithon stones at Baalbek? Some make the point that the trilithon stones do not have Lewis holes in them like many of the other Roman stones at Baalbek. Lewis holes is the name for the holes that the Romans would drill in the stones for lifting with their cranes. Yes, the Romans had cranes, and although their cranes only had a 5-ton capacity, often they would combine many of them together, which would obviously give them a greater capacity. So why don't these three stones contain these holes, like all the rest of the stones at Baalbek? Well, first of all, I wouldn't be so sure that they don't. No one has ever seen what is on the ends of these stones. It may very well be that they decided against a straight-up or dead lift of the trilithon stones because of their weight, and instead decided to lift up only one side of the stone. You would really only need to lift it high enough and long enough to get even the smallest brace underneath it, because at that point you would have a number of mechanical advantages and therefore options. For example, watch as this man makes a stone hinge in his backyard all by himself using a simple counterweight method.
I've tried to do this without any mechanical machinery at all. I've used mostly sticks and stones for my equipment. No pulleys, no hoists, no metal levers. Just try to use gravity too, I believe is my favorite tool.
Whoop. The first goal is getting this block 3 feet off the ground.
In order to move it up to this point, I just rock the block back and forth, adding weight to that end, and that opens a gap on this side, and just slide a board in. Then I add the weight to that end.
There it goes.
And slide a board in on this end.
This shoring box acts like a jack, slowly raising the block.
But it's not really even necessary for them to have been lifted. A French paper written by Jean-Pierre Adam meticulously details how the stones could have been moved using the specifications provided by Marcus Vitruvius Pollio by constructing roads underneath the stones on rollers, and the roads were raised to lead to the exact place of their placement, which was easy at Baalbek because of the terrain, so it wouldn't require any lifting, and then using man-powered drums and a system of capstans to pull the stones along the road. This method would have only required 144 workers to accomplish. It's also helpful for people to remember that the largest stone ever moved in the world is the so-called Thunderstone in Russia, moved in the 1700s using no modern equipment. This stone is 1.5 tons larger than the largest trilithon stone, and we know that moving it didn't require any alien technology. Well, what about this claim?
What's really interesting about Baalbek is it's always been known as the landing place. There's an actual text from Sumerian times called the Epic of Gilgamesh. Gilgamesh actually claims to have seen rockets descend and ascend from Baalbek, the landing place.
These claims come directly from the writings of Zecharia Sitchin, and they are totally untrue. Baalbek was not called the landing place, and the Epic of Gilgamesh never speaks of rockets ascending and descending anywhere in it. Sitchin, when making this claim in his book, never tells the reader where they can find this in the Epic of Gilgamesh. This is probably because it makes it harder for the reader to check his facts. I will link the actual section of the epic as well as a link to the online resources to check the Sumerian text for yourselves at the website ancientaliensdebunked.com. Nowadays, all the Sumerian tablets, including their own dictionaries, are searchable online. Yes, the Sumerians wrote their own extensive and detailed dictionaries, so we don't have to trust Sitchin or anyone else. We can basically just ask the Sumerians what they thought a word meant. And it becomes painfully obvious to anyone that cares enough to look that Sitchin was at best totally incompetent as a translator, and at worst, a scam artist. See SitchinIsWrong.com to begin your journey in losing any confidence in the so-called translations of Zecharia Sitchin. In conclusion, the Trilithon stones are part of a necessary retaining wall, not a foundation, and such walls were common to the Greeks and Romans. The retaining wall was not part of the simple, original, much smaller temple at Baalbek, and we know from other retaining walls of similar size, built by the Romans at the same time and in the same area, that they were more than capable of moving and placing stones of that size and shape, also evidenced by their ability to move obelisks. This is especially true if you gave them over 200 years in which to do it. We will look at Incan megalithic sites like Machu Picchu all in one segment, because Incan stonemasonry was all done more or less the same way. In regard to Incan building, Ancient Aliens focuses most of its attention on the curved or beveled edges of the stones. They say that it looks like the edges of these stones were melted. Notice as we listen to them build the case for this, that the reason they believe this is true is based entirely on the way the stones look.
There are signs in many of these stones that show very large amounts of thermal heat have been applied to mold the stones in such a way that they fit perfectly. And so it really does raise a lot of questions.
If you look at the style the Sacsayhuaman wall was built, the blocks look as if they've been molded like putty. If you can mold stone into place, then all of a sudden, as crazy as this sounds, it makes more sense.
Now, melting granite or any other stone and reshaping it would leave unmistakable evidence in and on the stones themselves. In other words, if the rocks were melted, it would be easily provable. It would not be a matter of what the stones look like. It would be a simple yes or no question. Ancient Aliens skips this step of proving or disproving their theory. Instead, they assume that the rocks were melted based on the look of the stones and move on to the step of trying to figure out who would have the technology to melt stones.
I have a stone torch, which I use for sometimes shaping granite. And I mean, it generates a temperature of in excess of 3,000 degrees. 3,000 degrees. That's a lot.
When we look back at the ancients and we see a technology that they couldn't possibly know, there's only two possibilities of that. Either God did it, which we really don't think happened, or some high-tech civilization from another planet came and showed them how to do it, then took their materials and tools and went back home.
I think there's at least one more possibility that Mr. Dunn may have missed. Every shaped stone at any Incan site has what archaeologists call pit marks or pit scars. They occur when stone hammers are used to quarry and shape the stone. In addition, archaeologists have found a huge number of Incan stone hammers at the quarries. And, almost uniquely to the Incans, they are found at the building sites too, because the Incans only rough cut the stones at the quarries. They did the finish work on site, so the stones would perfectly fit the stones around them. Well, how did the Incans accomplish these beveled edges? They used a smaller gauge stone hammer for the outer section. The evidence for this can be seen on every single stone that has these edges. You can see that the pit scars are much more numerous and smaller on the edges, showing that more blows with a smaller stone was used to achieve the detail work. Another reason that this is no mystery to archaeologists is because there are a large number of stones in various stages of construction in the ancient Incan quarries. These stones reveal that indeed the Incan stonemasons were using some of the most basic tools, even for their time. If you would like to learn more about the details of this, I'll link you to some peer-reviewed papers that can tell you more than you'd ever want to know, including details of experiments done. For example, a single scientist in 90 minutes accomplished similar cuts with similar tools. And all of this makes what Dunn says here one of the most off-the-wall things ever said in the Ancient Alien series.
I can't help but think that whoever was behind this thought the process through from beginning to end. They didn't quarry the rock and then decide how the heck are we going to transport this. They knew from beginning to end what needed to be done, with whatever techniques and technology they were going to use. In industry today, there's a kind of an adage, keep it simple, stupid.
Based on his experience, Mike Dunn believes the simplest way to build the Great Walls of Machu Picchu would have been to transport small rocks to the site, then melt them, and use molds to fashion the exact size and shape needed.
So he says it's more simple to melt the granite. Something so complicated that we don't really even know how to do it today. Is that really the most simple solution he could come up with? And then to say that they poured the melted rocks into a mold. I mean, look at these walls. Can anyone look at this and say, yeah, that looks like they were made from the same mold? These are not exactly bricks of the same size and shape. Unless he wants to say that they made a new mold for every block. In which case we would go well out of the range of this being the most simple solution. As far as how the Incans moved the stones into place, they left us a lot of evidence behind in the form of ramps. There are Incan ramps all over the place, still in existence today, in the quarries and at the building sites. The Incans had one of the most massive workforces in all the ancient world. They were like the Roman Empire of the West, and they had an absolutely huge labor force at the ready for these types of projects. So we know these rocks were not melted and put into molds, as Ancient Aliens tells us. We actually know exactly how they made these rounded edges, because of the pit marks left behind, as well as the huge number of stone hammers found in the quarries. There are no mysteries that require alien input with Incan stonework. Many people are familiar with these images of stone heads, called moai by the locals. Ancient Aliens tells us that nothing is really known about them.
How in the heck did they make these? Where did they come from? And how did they move them? Nobody has the answer.
This isn't true at all. For instance, we know exactly how they were cut and shaped, because the construction of the moai was abandoned abruptly. So there are plenty of examples of moai in various stages of development. Also, the stone tools that they used to pound out the relatively soft volcanic rock were found all over the quarries. Here's a clip of one of the locals explaining to his grandson how the moai were built.
He thinks that 20 people carved this moai over a period of time of 5 to 6 years to this stage. This is our sections of people who were, you know, given as your assignment. This is your section you can carve, and you can see different, you know, ways of doing it, and you can clearly see the talking marks and how the people were carving and going in and make these deep cuts in the rock like this, that.
The channels reached around and eventually formed a boat-like keel until the statue could be snapped off and fully extracted.
Ancient Aliens spends most of its time here discussing the moving of the moai, and it's interesting the angle that they take, because it seems that they are aware that there have been many successful experiments moving moai with wooden sleds and minimal workers. So Ancient Aliens has to do what they do best, create a false dilemma.
But there is a unique problem with the idea of moving moai with sleds or rollers.
When you go to Easter Island, you don't get the impression they had enough wood to have rollers. And in fact, in the 1700s, the first four expeditions to Easter Island never really saw a tree. And so that's the real mystery of Easter Island. How can you move a multi-ton statue if you have no trees for rollers?
So, they say there are currently no trees on Easter Island. Therefore, they assume there were never any trees on Easter Island, and therefore, well, aliens. The problem with this is that there used to be a lot of trees on Easter Island, which we now know because of extensive pollen samples taken from the crater lakes, as well as other methods. In fact, the very reason there are no trees on Easter Island now is probably because they used all of them while moving and lifting over 1,000 moais over hundreds of years. In other words, they used all the trees. One interesting thing about Easter Island is regarding soil erosion. If you take a land that once had a lot of trees and cut them all down, then you will have a massive soil erosion problem. This is because there would be no more root systems to hold the soil in place. Also, the rains no longer have anything to stop their velocity. The soil erosion at Easter Island is so notorious that if you type soil erosion into a search engine, you will see that the Wikipedia page has a picture of Easter Island. Some of the moai actually have full bodies, they're not just heads, but because of soil erosion, even in a very short time, they have been covered up to their necks in soil. This is a direct result of the land being completely deforested. So we know for sure how these moai were cut and shaped, that is, with simple tools which are found all over the quarries. And we know that if they had trees on Easter Island, then there are no problems with moving them and prying them into place. And Easter Island used to have a lot of trees before their fascination with creating moai exhausted their supply.